Welcome to the Freedom Struggles podcast. I'm here with Nandike Shivalingam. He's an activist with Greenpeace. We're going to be discussing primarily issues of deforestation as well as what keeps him ticking as an activist. Nandike, thank you so much for doing this.
Yes, thank you.
Nandike, could you tell us something? Now we're talking about palm oil right now, and India happens to be the largest consumer of palm oil in the world. Most of our palm oil comes from Indonesia. What is the problem with this system?
Okay, as you said, we are the biggest consumers of palm oil in the world. And then with majority comes from Indonesia. The issue with palm oil is it's a lot of expansion, you know, of plantation of palm oil, oil palm, expands into forest areas in Indonesia, which actually emits a lot of carbon, you know, destroys habitat of, you know, endangered species like Sumatran tigers and elephants and rhinos, which are, you know, very endangered. And then also creates a lot of conflict with people who are depending on those forests for their livelihoods. So this is the key issue. So as biggest consumers in the world of palm oil, which is again from Indonesia, we think the Indian industry and the people in India have a responsibility to demand an accountability and, you know, and a system where no palm oil is grown from deforestation. So that's the crux of the issue.
What do Indians use palm oil for?
It's predominantly used for cooking in India, and then palm oil is also used for other manufacturing goods like snacks, biscuits, soaps, cosmetics. Almost most of the products that you see in your supermarket could contain palm oil.
Palm oil for cooking seems to be a healthier option. Tends to be relatively less expensive, especially for poorer classes in India. Isn't palm oil necessary almost for their sustainability, especially with regards to their cooking?
Definitely, yes. It's the cheapest among all cooking oil available. And then predominantly many people, the poorer classes, said depends on it. The issue is, it's not saying no to palm oil or boycotting palm oil. It's actually to promote an industry which is actually sustainable and then pushes for, you know, more deforestation free palm oil.
Greenpeace has called for a stop in all deforestation. Is that even possible? How would that work practically?
It is possible because we have a lot of plantations, existing plantations. So through actually efficiently producing palm oil and then, you know, looking at like we have a system called, you know, stratification methods to determine which are the key areas to protect, and then which are areas, you know, which degraded forest which, you know, they could expand into palm oil.
How does Greenpeace go about this? Is part of Greenpeace's job sensitizing the public while also working on sort of a policy front, or do you emphasize more on the communicating the public with regards to this?
In terms of palm oil, yeah, we do both. You know, we also work politically with the Indonesian government to sensitize them on the issues with forest and saving their remaining forest. We also look at the industry and what their practices are, and then look at companies who are buying from them and sensitizing the company. And then at terms sensitizing the people, not making people take action on certain companies who are not listening or not changing their practices. So it's a wide variety of, you know, mixed things that, you know, we do to actually achieve the end goal of zero deforestation, basically.
And what are some of the successes you have seen? So you've been obviously working on this issue for a while. What are some of the successes that Greenpeace has seen on the ground with regards to this?
On palm oil, like one of the world's biggest producers of palm oil called Golden Agri Resources, part of Sinarmas Group Indonesia, they actually came out with a policy after we campaigned for many years, you know, on their practices, bad practices. In 2011, they came out with a policy which actually is pretty progressive on, you know, saving their forest within their concessions. So then after that, we worked with them to identify, we are still working with them to, you know, establish or, you know, to make sure that their commitments are kept. So that's a very good, you know, win, you know, for Greenpeace and the people who are really focusing on these issues and, you know, for forests.
So as a consumer watching this right now, what can I do for me personally do with regards to supporting some of the work that you are doing?
Definitely you can follow this issue. I think there are so many things happening around, you know, palm oil or paper or even other issues. So when, you know, when things are exposed, when things are being brought to the public platform, you know, for people to see, when you take action, you know, and, you know, it could be anything. It could be a click of a button to send an email to the CEO, or phoning them, or, you know, completely reminding them, or engaging them, you know, in public engagement activities in their outlets, or it could be anything which a consumer could actually define depending on their capacity. Definitely, then when that happens, you know, when many people join together and then, you know, and, you know, together ask the company to change, they have to change, they cannot ignore it. You know,
sounds good. So how will I get to know with regards to what companies are using palm oil in their products and things like that? Are there resources available with regards to
that? There is a lot of online resources available. We also came out with a report last year called Frying the Forest, which actually talked about Indian industry and how, you know, who's involved in the trade and who are the people who are using palm oil in the so, and there are a lot of online platforms, you know, which gives this information on, you know, which products are using palm oil. But as such, looking at a product, and it's very difficult to say, you know, whether they test palm oil or not for a consumer. You need to get a bit deeper into things.
Another big issue with regards to deforestation is the whole issue with regards to coal and coal mining and regulation there. Could you tell us a little bit about what is the heart of the issue with regards to regulation of coal mining or the lack there?
So, as I said earlier, the issue is the commodity is changing. From Indonesia, if it's palm oil or pulp, and it's India, it's coal, the biggest, you know, issue. Again, like there, you know, it's first loss of habitat for, you know, we all want to save Indian tigers and Royal Bengal tigers. So it's primary thing, loss of habitat for tigers, you know, conflict with communities. Millions of people in India depend on, you know, forest for their livelihood. So their livelihoods, you know, goes for a toss because of mining issues. Pollution, you know, water consumption for the mining and thermal power plants, which actually, you know, water is diverted away from agriculture towards these power plants, becomes a very issue, you know, and the water scarcity and, you know, lack of agriculture production. So it's not one specific, it's a wide variety of issues that actually governs this whole sector.
And I'm assuming displacement of tribals also would be a lot.
Definitely, yes, yeah.
And India obviously has a very large population with regards to tribals, and I don't know if a lot of people know that. I mean, there's a significant percentage of tribals that are obviously put in danger in this regard. Who is responsible for all this? I mean, if you're telling me all these things about deforestation in this country, and I, as an urban middle class person, would say that's terrible, let's stop doing that. No. Who's stopping you? What's the problem?
It's basically the government, who actually coming out with this policy, which are, you know, which are threatening the forest and the people, you know, tribals who are living on them. And then a certain amount of corporate lobby, which wants the land for mining for their private profits. So who influences the government in order to come up with policies which are, you know, not in favor for the people or the forest, or, you know, or our future. So these are the two big hurdles that I see.
No, what's the solution to this now? So if there are obviously corporate interests, which obviously have a lot of financial backing, if they are in obviously cahoots with the government, I mean, that's two very big power players together, right? Then what kind of an impact can Greenpeace have? What kind of an impact can our audience have?
It's again, so there are many ways we could challenge this. So through legal routes, through actually defining areas where, you know, lobbying with the government to actually talk to the government in identifying certain important areas. For example, criteria for inviolate areas, where, you know, we push for government to actually take note of forest areas which have to be protected at any cost, without, you know, no-go areas for mining. And then, you know, gathering people support, you know, to actually meet their rights. Because FRA, the Forest Rights Act, actually stipulates that rights of people should be met before any forest diversion happens. So actually pushing those rights to be met is actually another big tool that, you know, we could use for, you know, to protect people and the forest.
You spoke about the Forest Rights Act. What kind of successes have you seen in this regard, with regards to the work that you're doing?
Maybe not. There have been cases, a Vedanta case, where, you know, where people really fought for their rights, and then those companies were, you know, not given the required permissions because they were violating the Forest Rights Act. So there have been cases in the past where, you know, people fighting, and, you know, actually being successful. And there are a lot of fights that are going on right now, you know, where people are fighting for their rights, you know, with various, it could be coal mining or any other mining that, you know, occurs. So there are successes in the pockets. But we need to actually push the government to actually take note of the issue as a central issue, that, you know, it's happening everywhere in the country, and, you know, not only in coal belts, it's on all the mining areas. And then they should come up with saying, okay, yes, we'll first meet the rights of people, and then, you know, determine which are the important forest areas which, you know, no-go for mining at any cost. So that is not right. So our work is actually push for a central, you know, solution to this. You know.
One might argue with regards to the reduction in coal production, two things might happen. One, there might be a drastic reduction in employment by these companies that employ obviously thousands of people in particular areas where they might not necessarily have other options for livelihood. Another issue, which is a much larger issue, is we're obviously a growing country, a growing economy. We need power, and we need a lot of power. What are the alternatives to this?
So our demand is actually, we are actually asking for a moratorium on all new allocations of coal mines. You know, what we are saying is, we don't need to go on keep on doing this, because we have enough power, you know, we have given clearances for enough power projects, we have given clearances for enough mining, therefore, so we have enough clearances so that, you know, like our mining capacity can be doubled.
Doubled from what it is now?
What it is now. So therefore, the question of, you know, people going out of jobs is, you know, it's invalid, because it's already done. But what the government and the other private companies are doing is, they are pushing for more and more land, you know, so that, you know, they can. It's like a land grab, basically. It's nothing. It's not for people's. It's not to save people's livelihood, or, you know, to provide energy security for the country. It's basically a real estate deal that the government and other people are trying to do for their profits.
a lot of people that listen to this podcast and that watch this podcast now are also involved in a lot of these different issues. Could you tell us a little bit about your time here at Greenpeace and your work here and some of the challenges that you faced, and then also what keeps you going through those challenges?
So we always, you know, if you look, whether it could be a palm oil palm oil company or the government or the mining company, these are all big players who have, you know, big resources in terms of money and political clout. So when you have to work, you know, sensitize them, you know, change their practices, which is change itself is a very difficult thing to come, you know, so that's the biggest challenge, you know, how do you change these big entities like the government or corporates towards a solution. So that's the key challenge. What keeps everybody who's active is going is, you know, the hope that, you know, the change is still possible, and then, you know, as soon as we realize that, you know, the change is possible, and then we are willing to spend our time towards that solution, definitely we could achieve it. So that's the hope that drives us. It's not late.
So when you wake up every day and you're thinking, the largest people that are against you are the government and are these large corporates and things like that, that seems to be almost insurmountable challenges that a lot of people tend to go through. And your main argument is small change, right? Like picking away, and eventually you'll be able to make sort of a larger change. Is that something that you see a lot of other activists also doing, and do you see a success in that particular form?
Definitely, it's not only Greenpeace, it's not alone in this fight. It's millions of tribal people who are fighting for their rights and their livelihood. It's millions of other organizations who are working with them, you know, working for various strands, you know, like it be any strand. So it's not only one person. So it gives hope, and we know that, you know, there are people really fighting this fight with you, you know. So that's another thing that keeps you driving every day.
The sense of desensitization, there's so many things going wrong. How can I care about orangutans in Indonesia, right? Why do I need to care about tigers in some forest somewhere when I have so many of my own issues happening in the urban environment? Why does that matter? Why do I need to care about Indonesia? Why do I need to care about Indonesia?
So whatever happens across the world, it could be to Indonesia or the Amazon forest or the forest in Africa, it affects us in some way, through climate or through other things. Therefore, it also, you know, it's, we need to act on that as well. You know, we cannot say it's somebody else's problem, therefore, you know, we can be. It's like saying that, you know, I live in city, I don't have to care about tribals who are living in the forest. But we do care about, a lot of people do care about tribals and their rights and everything. So it's looking outside, you know, our circles to see, you know, where the problem exists. And if you really feel for the cause and for that issue, then definitely you could do a lot of things to change that.
Nikesh, thank you so much for doing this. We appreciate it. You've been listening to Nandakesh Shivalingam, an activist with Greenpeace. For this and more episodes, please visit our website, freedomstruggles.in. If you'd like to join us in the conversation, please shoot us an email, freedomstruggles@gmail.com.